Terence Trent D'Arby, and to know someone, come downstairs and meet the gentleman. Welcome back to Going Live.
Hi, thank you for
welcome back. You were watching that video really very closely. I mean, it's not the first time you've seen it, is it?
It's the first time I've seen it in about 3 months.
Do you see new things in it after 3 months, things that you didn't spot before?
I think every time you see it, you'd see new things you wouldn't spot before. It's sort of extremely layered, and it would take a long time to sort of absorb everything. I've seen stills of it where I sort of go, well, gee, I didn't know that was there.
Right, whose was the baby?
I honestly don't know. I think it was a woman who perhaps might have needed the milk money or something. I really don't know.
Put my baby in the video, she said. Where did you go? Because you sort of stormed onto the music scene. Everyone was talking about Terence Trent D'Arby, and then it went very quiet for quite a long time.
I just, to a large degree, a lot of times, especially in England, when people, where were you? I was basically sort of the rest of the world, doing a lot of things there. And then there was a period of time where I just had to, take a rest, because it had just gone so fast, it had gotten so much so quickly, so soon, that it was like an overload for a while. So I just had to sort of regroup and gather my wits.
Gather it all together.
Yeah.
You did say of the first album, Hardline, Hardline was the best debut album by a male solo act in this century, which are quite grand words, but you were having everyone on a little bit, really, weren't you?
I was having everyone on mainly about everything. The thing that I find most interesting is that people took all that seriously, especially, you know, in England, where every 6 months there's a new pop performer who comes and says things like that. I didn't mean most of the things that
every
I said.
Every 6 weeks.
Well, excuse me, every 6 days, but, you know. I didn't mean any of that. I mean, because I remember that particular week, I started out by saying this was the best of this decade. And then I started to say it was the best of this. And then I said, oh, it's better than Sgt. Pepper's. Yeah. And that was all in the space of a week. Right. So I didn't really believe it.
Guaranteed to get you a headline.
Yeah.
All right, we have some questions from the floor. Sarah, first of all.
What first got you interested into music?
The first thing that got me interested into music was when I was about five or six. I remember singing in this church service, and it's immediately after I finished singing, this real big older woman, maybe like a grandmother, she just came and gave me this really big hug, and she gave me a quarter, which at that time was like a lot of money if you were a little kid, you know. So I was able to go and buy candy, and I thought, if you get this type of attention and this type of money to spend on candy, I think I want to do music.
Yeah. And what a lot of candy you can buy now. Julie.
Did your career in journalism help you to write songs?
I would say that probably dabbling in creative writing when I was in school might have helped a bit. I don't think the career in journalism helped me in much, to be honest, especially this age. You okay?
Checking there. All right. Just giggling. I'm mad now.
Trying to get all the attention. That's what.
Leo. Where's Leo? Up here.
Why did you join the army?
I joined the army because I was living in this small town at the time called Deland, Florida, which is about 20 miles from Daytona Beach. And I just had nothing to do. I was really bored. I'd gone to university for a year. And I was bored, you know. And it was a way for me to get out. I'm glad in retrospect I did, because it was what enabled me to come to Europe. And once I came to Europe, I knew I'd never really go back and live in America again.
All right, Alex?
Don't join, all right? Just do yourself a favor. Don't join the army.
When you did boxing, did you win any titles?
Yes, I won the Golden Gloves for the Florida Golden Gloves in the, I think it was lightweight. Well, it could have been featherweight, I'm not sure. But featherweight doesn't sound as good as lightweight. They both don't sound as good as heavyweight, but wasn't much I could do about that.
All right.
Are you seeing a doctor about this cough?
Yeah.
How long have you had it?
Oh, ages.
Is this the tail end of that awful flu that went around?
No, it's permanent.
Oh, no, is it?
God.
Yeah, I used to have one of those. I found out I was allergic to hamsters. You haven't got a hamster, have you?
Yeah.
Aye. Go see the doctor. You might be allergic to hamsters. Scott.
Why did you come to London to launch your career when you originally come from America?
Well, I didn't really come to London to launch a career. I came because I was living in Europe for 5 years before I moved to London. Well, that's not true, actually. I did sort of come to London to launch a career, but that's because the record company I was signed to was based in London. And it just made more sense than living in Germany at the time where I was living to just come here. But I didn't come to Europe to make it as a performer. I came over with the army, decided that I was much more comfortable here, and then I stayed.
Terrific. Thank you very much indeed for the moment. Will you come back a little bit later on and do the prize?
Yes, I will do.
That's great. You haven't got a bad leg or anything, have you?
No, it's someone gave it to me, another sort of performer who I have a close affiliation with. And he gave it to me, and I sort of carry it basically as an affectation.
Who was
it
looks performer? Good.
I'm not telling you.
Oh, come on.
I'm not telling you.
No, come on.
I'm not telling you.
I'll try and find out. Okay, thank you very much indeed for the moment.
You're welcome.
Singing Corner.